Everybody has a handout? Okay, great. at least you won't go away empty-handed. That's the only advantage. Okay. Before beginning, then, I want to recall as a kind of motto, an epigraph, one sentence written by the German poet Friedrich Hölderlin in a letter to a friend, in which Hölderlin sought to designate what was what he found to be tragic in the contemporary world. This is the first quote on your sheet. He wrote, "For this is what is tragic with us, that packed up without a sound, in no matter what kind of container, we depart from the realm of the living, rather than atoning in flames for the flame we are incapable of taming." If you think that's difficult, it is difficult. And I'm not sure that I understand it myself, but you'll see that it has a certain relevance to the story I'll be commenting, which is Kafka's hunter Gracchus. For many years, indeed ever since long ago, I translated Adorno's essay Notes on Kafka, which is the concluding text of a collection of essays called Prisms, I've been puzzled but also challenged by a remark he makes there concerning Kafka's short story, The Hunter Gracchus. It's quote two on your sheet. Adorno writes, "Perhaps this is what is meant by the tale of Gracchus, the once wild hunter, a man of force who was unable to die, just as the bourgeoisie failed to die. History becomes hell in Kafka because the chance that might have saved was missed. As in Kafka's twisted epics, what perished there was that which had provided the criterion of human experience, namely a life lived out to its end. Gracchus is the consummate refutation of the possibility banished from the world, namely to die after a long and full life." So Adorno. I want to try today to respond a bit to the puzzlement that these sentences of Adorno, for whom I had and whom I retain the utmost respect, caused me at the time and still cause me today. Namely, above all, his assertion that Gracchus, because Gracchus was unable to die, this makes him an appropriate figure for a certain bourgeoisie which has also refused to pass away, and in so doing, so Adorno, has blocked the path to what he calls the, quote, the chance that might have saved. Saved from what? At the very least, Adorno suggests, from the loss of what he takes to be the fundamental criterion of human experience, namely, quote, life lived out to its end. My problem, then, with Adorno's assertion was and remains this. First of all, is Gracchus really unable to die? And if so, how does this inability reflect the loss of an experience based on a life lived out to its end? In German, I know some people speak German here, das aus sich heraus zu Ende gelebte Leben. In trying to discover just what in Kafka's text might support this reading, I've always been very sympathetic with the general rule that Adorno himself stated in the same essay about how to read Kafka. Adorno wrote, quote three on your sheet, "The first rule is take everything literally. Cover up nothing with concepts invoked from above. Kafka's authority is textual. Only fidelity to the letter, not oriented understanding, can be of help." End quote. However, reading Kafka, and probably most other texts as well, reading Kafka literally, without some sort of what Adorno calls oriented understanding, turns out to be a difficult, if not impossible, task. And this for a number of reasons. First, because, initially at least, one reads words and sentences and not letters. and these words and sentences require some sort of prior oriented understanding in order to be recognized as words and sentences. Second, in the case of Kafka, these words and sentences tend often to contradict or undercut one another, requiring from the reader, therefore, further intervention, whether oriented or not. Specifically, concerning the assertion that Gracchus has failed to die, in German, dem das Sterben misslang, the following exchange between Gracchus and his host, the mayor of Rever, Mr. Salvatore, where the hunter's boat has brought him, this exchange is rather indicative of the problems faced by such an effort to read literally. "Are you dead?" the mayor asks him. And Gracchus responds at first unequivocally, quote, "For yes, many years ago, it must have been a great many years ago, I fell from a rock in the Black Forest," that's in Germany, "as I was tracking a chamois. Since then, I've been dead." But the conversation, the story, doesn't stop there. The mayor is not entirely satisfied with Gracchus' answer. "But you're also alive," he counters. And Gracchus answers, "To a certain degree, gewissermaßen. To a certain degree, I am also alive." To a certain degree, this is, of course, one of the things that might jolt what Adorno would call oriented understanding, insofar, namely, that is not in our habit of thinking about life and death in this way, above all of their relationship, namely as one of degrees. In German, I note in passing, it's really a question not so much of degrees as of a certain measure, gewissermaßen. But the way this measure is employed here by Gracchus works precisely to upset the certitude of oriented understanding. This disruption begins by challenging the established notion that what we call life and death are mutually exclusive, except perhaps where ghosts are concerned, but Gracchus does not appear or behave like a typical ghost. What then are the implications of this disrupted opposition of life and death? Surely not that the difference between the two is simply denied or effaced. One might be tempted here to invoke the notion of survival to describe Gracchus's condition, but that doesn't seem entirely appropriate either. For if Gracchus is to some degree also alive, as he puts it, it's not as what we would ordinarily call a survivor. The notion of survival generally implies not just the preservation of identity, but its elevation, even a certain resurrection or enhancement. This, however, has precisely not happened, as we'll soon see. Rather, something very different is at stake in Kafka's text. It seems more appropriate to say that Gracchus has not survived, but rather he has outlived himself. He has left his previous life and is now condemned to wander. Quote, quote seven, "I've been lying here," "He's now condemned to wander about the world without any discernible end in sight. He is therefore out of life, he's outlived life, without therefore being in anything other than his coffin and the boat that carries that coffin from port to port." Having listened to the hunter describe his wanderings, his host and interlocutor, Mayor Salvatore of Riva, cannot resist posing the following question. "And have you no share in the world beyond?" asked the mayor, wrinkling his brow. "I am," the hunter responded, "always on the immense staircase leading up to it." Death, in other words, has not brought Gracchus the ascension he had hoped for and expected. But this hope and expectation persists precisely in its absence. "I am always on the immense staircase leading up to it." The hunter, he says of himself, the hunter has been turned into a butterfly. Don't laugh. Thus, the passage upward toward another and presumably better world is blocked. or, as we'll see, has been missed. And for Gracchus, this is no laughing matter. Like a butterfly, he moves, quote, sometimes up, sometimes down, sometimes on the right, sometimes on the left, always in motion, and yet not going anywhere, not at least toward the place where a certain oriented understanding might have expected him to go. His movement is more, as we've seen, like the rocking of a boat. Quote 6, I wake up on my old ship. I lie on a wooden plank, wearing, I'm no delight to look at, wearing a shroud. At my head stands a church candle that illuminates me. Like the moderns described by Hölderlin in the letter I quoted at the outset, Gracchus is in a container, in a box. But unlike Hölderlin's description, he does not go quietly out of the world. Indeed, he does not go at all, if going means departing. He remains in order to tell his story that is both singular and yet perhaps not all that uncommon. Quote 7, a rather longish quote. I have been lying here since the time when I, the still living hunter Gracchus, was pursuing a chamois to its home in the Black Forest and fell. Everything took place as it should. I followed, fell down, bled to death in a ravine, was dead, and this boat was supposed to carry me to the other side. I still remember how happily I stretched myself out there on the planking for the first time. I had been happy to be alive and was happy to be dead. I gladly threw away my ragtag collection of guns and bags and slipped into the shroud like a young girl into her wedding dress. Everything took place as it was supposed to. Everything was in order. Up to this point, this sounds very much like what one might imagine Adorno to have meant with the notion of a life lived out to its end. This, at least, is how Gracchus describes it. The accident is not that he fell into a ravine and died. The accident is that his death did not turn out as expected, by him at least, and I would add, by the entire culture and tradition symbolized by that church candle placed at the head of his coffin. Apart from this candle and a few other silly pictures, as he calls them, my wooden cage is quite empty. It contains his body, his corpse, but it does not transmit, much less transfigure, his soul. Only one of those silly pictures does Gracchus take the trouble of describing. It is of what he calls a bushman, a heathen, aiming his spear at me, as he says, and taking cover as best he can behind a beautifully painted shield. The picture is the result of a certain state of mind, which conceives of the outside, of everything not illuminated, let's say, by the sacramental candle, to be aggressively menacing, or potentially so. The figure depicted seems to fix its aim at the viewer, in this case Gracchus, in his otherwise empty wooden cage. Now, at this point in the dialogue, his interlocutor, Mayor Salvatore, responds with empathy, and then with a significant, if troublesome, question. A horrible destiny, said the mayor, raising his hand defensively, mit abwehrend erhoben Hand. And you bear no blame for it? The mayor seeks to ward off the shock of what Gracchus has just recounted with a movement of his hand. And part of that defense is to search out the culprit as the cause. The German word here, translated as blame in English, is, however, Schuld, which also means guilt. If Gracchus fell to his death and then failed to be elevated afterwards, it can only be, so at least a certain oriented understanding, because we are dealing with the punishment of a guilty transgression. This suspicion, however, is emphatically rejected by the hunter Gracchus. "I was a hunter," he said. "Is there any blame, guilt in that?" Meyer Salvatori is ready to concede this point, without, however, abandoning his search for a guilty culprit. No salvation without guilt. He says, "That's not for me to decide, but then who is to blame?" Gracchus's only answer, brief and laconic, is that it must have been the boatsman. A wrong turn of the wheel, a moment's absence of mind, the distraction of my lovely native country. "I cannot tell what it was," he says. The figure of the pilot or helmsman is often associated with Christ or the church, to whom is often ascribed the role of leading the living out of this world, the world of sin, guilt, and mortality, into the next, and thus helping mortals to survive. And of course, there are Greek and other antecedents to the boatsman. This is perhaps, for a certain culture at least, one of the most powerful examples and models of what Adorno calls oriented understanding. It goes back to a certain Orient, but whose original East Gate is barred. Oriented understanding, therefore, looks westward, to the West, to the Occident, as the path forward and upward, and perhaps above all, the path back again. The problem then of Gracchus is not that he could not die. He is dead, but only to a certain degree, in a certain measure. For the historically established measure of what is called death has, for many at least, long been that of a passageway to another and possibly higher life. Out of the interruption of identity should thus arise its continuation, its perfection without end. It is this expectation, at any rate, this hope, this oriented understanding, that Gracchus's destiny challenges. For Meyer Salvatori agrees that Gracchus seems not to have deserved his fate, but this still leaves the decisive question, decisive at least for Meyer Salvatori, unanswered. He says, "To me as well, there seems to be no sin in such things. But then, whose is the guilt?" All Gracchus can think of to answer is once again, the boatman. The one who is charged with effectuating the move, the transition, from this life to another, this is the one who is somehow guilty. For only if a culprit can be found can the misfortune that has befallen him be made rationally understandable, rather than remaining an enigmatic and unthinkable contingency. But Meyer Salvatori's insistent search for a culprit to whom guilt can be assigned leads to a surprising response on the part of the hunter Gracchus. After repeating that it's the boatsman who will have to bear the blame, Gracchus immediately goes off in an extremely unexpected direction. Quote 8 on your list. "No one," he says, "will read what I write here. No one will come to help me. If the task were that of helping me, all the doors of all the houses would stay closed, all the windows shut, everyone lying in bed, sheets thrown over their heads, a nightly hostel, the entire earth. And that makes good sense, for no one knows of me. And if he did, he would have no idea where I was staying. And if he knew that, he still would not know how to keep me there. And if he knew that, he would still not know how to help me. The thought of wanting to help me is a sickness and has to be cured with bed rest." Gracchus, you see, doesn't complain. He doesn't bemoan his state. He merely describes what seems to be one of its ancillary effects, or is it perhaps its condition? Any straightforward response to this ambiguity is rendered even more difficult by the paradoxical nature of that description, of what he describes. He says, after all, "No one will read what I write here." For the first and last time, the hunter Gracchus describes himself as writing. And this abruptly and unexpectedly alters his situation. for he is no longer simply a hunter or even a character speaking in a story, but rather also and at the same time a writer of his life, his death, and their unnameable aftermath. What is it that allows Gracchus so abruptly to say that what he has been recounting is not just spoken, but written? It is quite simply, or not so simply, the fact that this story is not what the hunter Gracchus is ultimately about. The story is about what surrounds the hunter and his discourse. It is about its setting. And it's here that we come upon what could be called its cinematographical dimension. This was originally written for a conference about the end of the world in cinema. So I was happy to, if it comes here a little bit out of nowhere, but you'll see. The writing that seems cinematographical, the writing that seems only to designate a discourse spoken by a main character to his interlocutor, in fact, describes both more and less than that. It describes images that must be read and not just seen. A moment of inattention on the part of the boatman may have been part of Gracchus's destiny, and indeed a different sort of attention is required to grasp the nature of his writing, which describes not just objects, things, and events, but also their setting, which literally surrounds Gracchus and sets the scene of his story. It is this scene, S-C-E-N-E, that describes why the desire to help could be called a sickness. If the task were that of helping me, all the doors of all the houses would stay closed, all the windows shut. And he continues, quote 9, I know that, and so I do not shout to summon help, even though at moments I think seriously about it. But to drive out such thoughts, I need only look about me, umherblicke, and verify where I am, and I can safely assert where I have been for hundreds of years. Attention here is therefore required, not just to the apparent goal or object or figure, but above all to its surroundings in space, but also in time. Where Gracchus is now, but where he's also been, as he writes, for hundreds of years, is in places such as Riva, where his arrival is described as follows. And I now go to the beginning of this story, where his arrival is described. This is how the story begins. Quote 10. No one bothered, it's not the beginning of it, no, sorry, it's the second part of the beginning. I'm working my way backward toward the beginning. No one bothered with the newcomers on the jetty, even when they set the beer, the coffin, down to wait for their helmsman, who was still working with the ropes. No one came up to them. No one asked them any questions. No one took a closer look at them. The helmsman was further held up a little by a woman with disheveled hair, who now appeared on deck with a child at her breast. Then he came on land, pointing to a yellowish two-story house that rose close by, directly at the left, near the water. The bearers took up their load and carried it through the low door, furnished with slender columns. A small boy appeared and opened a window, noticed immediately how the group was disappearing into the house, and hastily shut the window again. The door closed. Gracchus arrives. His coffin is borne on land amid total indifference, or so it would seem. But is it indifference that leads the little boy to open the window and then brusquely to shut it again as he notices the procession passing by? This procession had been temporarily held up by the presence of a woman with disheveled hair nurturing a baby. Birth and death pass each other by for an instant, and corpse, the mother's disheveled child and corpse, the mother's disheveled hair, providing a certain contrast to the helmsman directing the unloading of the coffin. Why does the little boy shut his window so hastily? Why is his curiosity replaced perhaps by anxiety, or as we may assume, or perhaps by boredom, or both? We find a possible indication at the very beginning of the story, perhaps its most cinematic moment. It is here that we can look for a certain origin of the indifference, if indeed it is indifference, that greets, or rather doesn't greet, that ignores Gracchus' arrival. Quote 11, this is the way the story begins, in fact. Two boys were sitting on the wall by the jetty playing dice. A man was reading a newspaper on the steps of a monument in the shadow of a hero wielding a saber. A young girl was filling her pail with water at a fountain. A fruit seller was lying next to his produce, looking out to sea. Through the empty openings of the door and window of a bar, two men could be seen drinking wine in the back. The landlord was sitting at a table in the front, dozing. A small boat slipped lightly into the small harbor as if it were being carried over the water. It's the beginning of the story. Note the paratactic structure of this highly visual, highly scenic description, which at first reads almost like an album of distinct and disparate photographs. One, two boys playing dice. Two, a man reading a newspaper under a monumental shadow of a saber-wielding hero. Three, a young girl getting water at a fountain. Four, a fruit seller lying by his produce and gazing out to sea. Five, two men seen drinking wine through the empty opening of the door and window of a bar, in front of which the landlord was sitting at a table. This last image includes the representation of its own visibility as image, namely the frame of the window and the door through which it is seen. There is absolutely no connection, no obvious direct connection between these five scenes or images. No connection if it's not their lack of connection. They're all simply there at the dock, neither waiting nor doing anything in particular, or rather doing everything but only in particular. Nothing adds up. There's no bottom line. This is the world into which the boat bringing Gracchus glides as though it were being carried over the water. Although the time of day is nowhere indicated in this story, there's every reason to see this opening scene as a kind of twilight of aesthetics, either very early morning or early evening, especially if the word twilight is taken not literally, as Adorno would have it, but at its word, which means to see it as a splitting of light, a twi being two, a splitting of light. For the scene is composed of images that are not just discontinuous, but are also split. They are split between the objects they seem to render visible and the position in which those objects are represented. In this sense, the images are, like Gracchus, constantly in movement, although like Gracchus, it's not clear if they have any particular goal. Boys shooting dice, a fruit seller lying next to his wares, gazing out to sea, two men drinking in the bar framed by the open windows and doors, the bar owner sleeping out front. There seems little room here for oriented understanding, and perhaps not much more room for a life lived out of itself, as Adorno puts it, a life such as that described by the hunter Gracchus. Is this possibly what the story is about? No one bothered with the newcomers on the jetty. No one, that is, except perhaps the boy who opens his window to look and who almost immediately closes it in order not to see. His gesture here recalls that of another figure at a window, seen by Kay as he's being led off to his death at the end of the trial, quote 12. Kay's gaze, his gaze fell upon the top story of the building adjoining the quarry. Like a light flicking on, the casements of a window flew open. a human figure, faint and insubstantial at that distance and height, leaned far out abruptly and stretched both arms out even further. Who was it? A friend? A good person? Someone who cared? Someone who wanted to help? End quote. For Gracchus, as for K, there is no help. For the desire to help is a sickness. It is this desire that situates the hunter Gracchus, not as a character, but perhaps as a nightmare figure of a society that cannot deal with its finitude other than by ignoring it or by seeing it as the result of a guilt that must be punished before it can be redeemed. Gracchus does not say this in so many words, but perhaps he writes it. He writes it without writing, but by allowing the disparate images of Riva to emerge as the environment of routine and rejection that makes of him a wanderer. Adorno notwithstanding, Gracchus is a figure of death, of a death that hopes to wrap itself up and be borne away, perhaps toward an eternal life. But he is also the figure of the blockage of such hopes and of the ricochet of fear that results. This, like Gracchus, has been going on for centuries, and like Gracchus, it so shows little sign of going away, which is why for Gracchus himself, there will be no rest, curative or otherwise. 13th last quote. Extraordinary, said the mayor. Acts extraordinary. And now do you think of staying here in Riva with us? I think not, said the hunter with a smile. And to excuse himself, he laid his hand on the mayor's knee. I'm here. More than that, I do not know. Further than that, I cannot go. Gracchus, figure of a hunter who no longer hunts, who is not immobile, but also who does not pass away. Like a text full of words and images that do not simply speak for themselves, but rather that signify in tandem, in and through their separation from one another. Perhaps this is why this highly cinematographical text, describing a world that is incapable of ending, an anti-apocalypse, if you will, is no less apocalyptic for outliving itself, and it's also why this text perhaps still awaits its translation into film. If that translation ever does take place, and I believe the text calls for it, let us hope that among the images of the docks of Riva, of the boy at the window, of Mayor Salvatore, and above all, of course, of the hunter himself, let's hope that the picture of that bushman hung on the wall of the otherwise empty cabin is not overlooked, aiming his spear at me and at all who consent to look at him, to read this text. It will take a lot more than 3D to render its force. Thank you.